Welcome to Coffee with Dan. This morning, we are going to discuss about a very important area in this country, that is about aviation. And our topic for today is civil aviation in Sri Lanka. I have with me this morning Mr. H.M.C. Nimalsiri. He is the Director General of Civil Aviation Authority of Sri Lanka and the Chief Executive Officer of the authority. He holds a Bachelor of Science degree from University of Colombo and a Master of Science degree in Computer Science from University of Colombo. Welcome to Coffee with Dan, Mr. Nimalsiri.
Thank you, Dan.
So, let us turn to our first question. What is civil aviation all about and how did it start operations and what type of significance that he has in the country?
Yeah, basically in relation to your question, what is civil aviation? This civil aviation subject came into being after the World War II. During that time, the aircraft was developed for the purpose of war. In fact, after Wright brothers introduced the plane in 1903, aircraft started developing towards the military use. But after the war, countries felt that use of aircraft for war purposes is now over and they should be used for peaceful purposes. So as a result, most of the countries were invited by the United States of America to Chicago City to have a detailed discussion how this valuable equipment can be used for peaceful purposes. So at that time, the President Roosevelt was the key figure, summon all the states, and there in 1944, the countries agreed on a convention on international civil aviation. And after, I think, 39 days of deliberation, on the 7th December 1944, laid the foundation for the signing of the Convention on International Civil Aviation Day. Today is the 7th December 2017, and we mark 73rd anniversary of the signing of the convention. So we call today the International Civil Aviation Day. And basically, civil aviation is to make use of the airspace for the development of countries. Economy basically, and also social integration. And our main task is to regulate the civil aviation industry in line with the expectation of the convention, which is to promote civil aviation for peaceful purposes without having undue competition and also avoiding the waste. So basically, as the Civil Aviation Authority, our primary task is to regulate the entrance to the field of civil aviation, having ensured that they would be conforming to the international standards and recommended practices and the legislative framework. So after certifying them, it is our duty to ensure that they will continue to adhere to the applicable requirements, and if there is any deficiency, we need to bring it to their notice and put them back on the track. But if there is any willful violation, we have to deal with them as provided in the law. So our primary task is that.
I understand that Civil Aviation Authority of Sri Lanka is the watchdog on aviation affairs.
Yes.
And in one respect, you have to maintain the airworthiness of this country's airspace,
yes,
as well as on the other hand, to ensure that proper aviation services are provided to the aeroplanes and the flights that are flying over our airspace. So what sort of function and powers and authorities that your regulating authority has with regard to those things?
Yeah, we have comprehensive powers entrusted upon the Civil Aviation Authority by the Act of by the Act number 14 of 2010, Civil Aviation Act, and Before that, we had the Air Navigation Act of 1950, but that act did not have sufficient teeth to regulate the industry as per the current status. So now, under the Civil Aviation Act number 14 of 2010, we have powers not only to regulate the entrance, but also to conduct continuous surveillance and also take the enforcement action. So what is envisaged is that any operator, he may be an airport operator or airline operator or air navigation service provider, whoever who is linked either with the safety or security matter relating to civil aviation, need to be properly certified by us, having checked their compliance with the applicable rules and regulations, especially the international standards, because aviation is essentially being international. The moment an aircraft take off from this country, and if it flies to another country, there should be uniformity in the practices and procedures so that there will be seamless operation. Now, in order to ensure that, everybody has to fall in line with the same standards. So we call it SARPS, that is Standard and Recommended Practices. Basically, those are considered to be the minimum. State can go for higher things, but at least this minimum standards are to be maintained. So when we certify entrants, we ensure that these minimum standards are be maintained. For instance, if somebody wants to establish an airline, we will look at their organization, personnel, equipment, that is aircraft, then the procedures, written procedures, services and facilities, and all are thoroughly looked into at the time of entry. And when an airline is formed, aircraft are brought from one country, people are brought from different places, and they are put together with a view to carry in passengers, and unless these things are well looked after and properly the certified, it may lead to certain disasters. Now, today, out of all mode of transport, surface transport, sea transport, air transport is the most safest, expeditious, efficient, regular, and environmentally friendly the mode of transport. And especially when it comes to distant travel, it is the only mode of travel available to people. So now, today, by the end of 2017, as per the estimate of the International Civil Aviation Organization, 4.2 billion people have traveled, and only 3 accidents have happened, and fatalities is only 47. So we have a very impressive safety record established. And as you know, then these people have the instinct ability of walking and swimming, but not flying. When you look at our sea transport and surface transport, we have a lot of accidents. But this mode of travel, where we are not have instinct ability, we have maintained a very high level of safety. So that is not by accident, but by design. Everybody engaged in this business is very much committed to maintain the required standards. So that is achieved through the state body in charge of the implementation of regulations, and we have done it to our best of abilities. And now in the International Civil Aviation Organization conducts audits on each member state to see how well they have implemented these standards, the degree of compliance. Now, we were assessed about a few years back, and we were found to be the number one in the South Asia region, and we have taken the place of fourth place in the Asia Pacific region out of 34 states, and we have taken the 19th place in the world out of 191 states in regard to effective implementation of international standards locally. So that itself shows what contribution that Civil Aviation Authority of Sri Lanka has done to maintain high level of standards here, because unless we maintain standards as per the Chicago Convention, other states are not supposed to recognize the license issued by us. So as a result, if we are found to be deficient, our pilots, air traffic controllers, engineers will not be accepted by other states. Similarly, our aircraft operated by Sri Lankan Airlines may be denied flying over their space or landing at their places. So however much an airline may be compliant with the standards will be immaterial if the state is found to be deficient in the effective implementation. So in that context, this particular act I referred to earlier had given us enormous powers, and we have done our part to the satisfaction of the general public.
Mr. Nimalsiri, you mentioned that the regularization and as well as all the other controls with regard to locally operated airlines, maybe that are flying internationally but also domestically, are controlled by obviously your authority. But what about the international services or international airlines that are coming to Sri Lanka? Are they also being controlled by your authority?
We can say yes and no, because when they are in Sri Lanka, that is after they come and land, we have the authority given not only by our Civil Aviation Act but also by the international standards to enter the aircraft and examine whether they are compliant with the standards. So for this purpose, we engage our inspectors to go on board on foreign aircraft once they land and see whether the minimum standards are being maintained. But our regulatory scope is there very limited, because we don't want any flight to be delayed due to this process of inspection. We call it a ramp inspection, where we will be doing a cursory inspection of the airline's compliance using checklist within a period of one hour, that is the standard turnaround time, and ensure that all the standards are satisfied. But we go on the premises that the state in which that aircraft has been registered has properly done their part. And how we can come to that conclusion is that International Civil Aviation Organization visit each member state and conduct the audits. So if there is any deficiency found during those audits, those are made available to us. So in the absence of any adverse report, we consider the foreign airlines come in here, have conformed to the applicable requirement. But in addition to that, we do this ramp inspection and ensure that minimum standards have been maintained.
Now, in the past, we have seen that there were these open skies agreements where the foreign airlines could use our airspace as well as we could use the other foreign airspace through these agreements. But this particular procedure now that is in place, is that what you just mentioned?
Yes, now this air services between two states take place under the air services agreement. So that is the formal way of negotiating the traffic rights between the two states. So there are certain terminologies we call freedoms of the air. Though we call it freedoms of the air, per se, those are not really freedoms. You have to get them in writing through agreements. And under the, we have famous five freedoms. The first and second freedom are basically to allow airlines to fly internationally. That is, first freedom is to fly over a state without landing. The second freedom is for an aircraft to land in another country for the purpose of technical reasons. Then those are of no commercial values, but that helps airlines to navigate from one place to another without a problem. But when it comes to third and fourth freedom, those are considered to be commercial rights. Third freedom is for an airline registered in this country to uplift passengers and take them to another country and disembark them there. Fifth is just the reverse, that passengers can be uplifted from that country and brought back to the country where the airline is registered. Then comes the fifth freedom, which is somewhat negotiated with due care, where we allow airline registered in one country to go on to the go to another country, and from there they can uplift passengers or disembark to another country. So usually that kind of traffic is not given freely, because it may affect the third and fourth freedom traffic rights between those two countries. So we are somewhat hesitant to apply those freedoms in view of the necessity of maintaining the third and fourth freedom, which promote the traffic between the two city pairs.
Now, the most important infrastructure in aviation are the airports. And domestically, we know that we have two main commercial airports, the Bandar Nayak on one hand and Matel on the other hand. Apart from these two main commercial airports, what is the present situation with the other domestic airports that we have, and are we heading towards renovating and advancing the facilities for the use of aviation?
Yeah, now good question. Now these airports, we have altogether 16 airports in this country. Bandar Nayak International Airport and Matel Rajapaksa International Airports are the two international airports, and rest of the airports are presently used as domestic airports. But over the last 30 years, these airports were under the airports because we were having the internal conflict, and airports, airfields were more used for state defense purposes. Now country has come to the normalcy, and we try to convert them to civil airfields. Basically, maintaining a land aerodrome cost us a lot of money, especially to give the perimeter security, and as well as operational costs are very high. So we have no intention of taking over all the domestic airports to civil aviation, because operational cost would be very high and our traffic levels are very less at the moment. At the moment, domestic aviation is more used by tourists and business people. Local community using air transport is very negligible because of various reasons. So we have taken a phased approach to convert these domestic airports to civil airports. So we have started this exercise with Batticaloa Airport. It has been under the airports completely, and we have taken it over, and we have now segregated. Our present policy is to cohabit one side for the civil, one side for the military, so that airports requirement can be continue to be exercised. At the same time, the other side would be available to traveling public without much of a security consideration. So far what has been happening is that because airports is controlling airfields and their camps are located within, any person entering those camps were subject to thorough security check, and that is considered to be a hassle by civil passengers. So we wanted it to be avoided. So as a result, we applied that in Batticaloa, where we have completely separated airports, and other side is being now converted to civil, so that passengers will not be subject to stringent security checks. So as in the case of Bandar Nayak International Airport, passengers would very soon be able to go to Batticaloa Airport and take civil flights. And gradually we will go towards other airports as well, because right now the demand for civil flights is somewhat limited. So volume of business is not sufficient for us to completely take over and run as civil airport. So we have a hybrid system running at the moment.
This morning in Coffee with Dan, we are discussing about civil aviation in Sri Lanka with Mr. H.M.C. Nimalsiri, who holds a Bachelor of Science degree from University of Colombo and a Master of Science degree from University of Colombo. He is one of the most experienced aviation professional in this country. He joined the aviation civil aviation department of Sri Lanka, and now he is presently the Director General of Civil Aviation and Chief Executive Officer of this authority, which is called basically the watchdog of civil aviation in this country. So turning back to our discussion, Mr. Nimalsiri, now you mentioned that there are two types of basically airports, like civil and military, and also within the civil structure, hybrid system that operates. Now, do we have aviation policy to regulate those hybrid situations? And also, are there any plans to privatize certain areas so that especially the domestic operation of small aircrafts to go from Colombo to Jaffna or Batiklo or New Orleans, for example, do we have this national policy in those lines?
Yes, in fact, recently we published the draft civil aviation policy, and now it is before the cabinet of ministers for final approval. This civil aviation policy we coordinated with the industry stakeholders, and all what should take place vis-a-vis what is being practiced has been stipulated there, and with that there will be opportunity for people to even construct private airfields, and our traffic rights negotiation of traffic rights would be more liberalized. We will go towards more open skies policy, and we will allow foreign investment in airline establishment. We will allow people to establish aviation training facilities. We would be able to give them lands for such purposes, and we have looked at what is happening in the rest of the world to make more use of airspace for economic development, especially that is the problem we have. We have not identified the potentials of aviation for economic development. Airspace is a public asset which has vast potential for economic development, which so far has not given proper thought and attention, and due to various reasons. Basically, the value of airspace can be given meaningful, basically we can make use of it for economic purposes only when peace is in place. So far, over the last 30 years, because of the problems, we could not make use of it. Now, we have identified the need, and the policy has been formulated as you ask, and very soon it will be published, and with that there will be more opportunities for people to get actively involved in airspace and bring dividends to the nation,
especially the private sector.
Yes.
Now my next question is based on the conference that your authority has these days, which is called the ICON 2017.
Yes.
So what do you expect out of this conference? So
that is an international conference which is organized by the International Civil Aviation Organization. That ICAN 2017 is the conference that we are holding here. That is an abbreviated form of a term, International Civil Aviation Organization Air Services Negotiation Conference. So, because the name is too long, we have called it ICAN 2017 because it is held this year. Intention is to, as I said earlier, air services agreement or air services between two countries take place under agreement between two nations. So, usually state have the habit of going from one state to the other to have this kind of air services agreement. Now, having identified the need of most of the states, International Civil Aviation Organization has thought of asking all the states to come to a particular point where state can negotiate with each other depending on their interests for operation of air services. This is the 10th time they are going to they are holding it, and we invited ICAO to come and have the conference here in Colombo with the primary intention of promoting tourism here. And now consequently 69 states have come here, the state delegations, and participants are about 450 people. They are from all corners of the world, so it is a good opportunity for us to promote especially tourism and outreach the rest of the world with our tourism potential, because people coming here are very affluent people, very high they are in society, they are in the high echelon of the respective countries, and they have very good connection. So we expect a lot of fringe benefits to come out of this conference. That is the very purpose why we wanted it here.
In line with the conference, do you also have a kind of exhibition for the general public to learn and get to know about the aviation?
No, because during this conference we have in the morning 1 hour session where we speak about very important topics. So it was open for public. In addition, today this evening we are having again 1 hour session to mark the 73rd anniversary of International Civil Aviation Organization. Dan asked a very valid question that the education is the necessity for the promotion of tourism. Now when it comes to agriculture, education, health, it is the public who demands the government as to what should happen. But in regard to aviation, it is not the case. People are unaware what it is and what the potential it has. So our primary task is to educate the public of the potential use of airspace, value of that. And for that purpose, we have started various education program. We are establishing school aviation clubs, and we publish a magazine called Gunasekera. And also this year we have started this, we have asked school children and then the public, general public, to take part in art competition. Basically we have given them an open topic, the potential of aviation for economic development. Under that they can draw arts and send us those pictures, so that we will select them the best and award them with some prizes. The first prize is to visit Singapore, Malaysia and likewise. And we try to get public involved in aviation matters.
Education and training is very important for the future of the industry, the future generation of the country, and that is an area that we can reach the world by giving the proper education and training to our youth who aspire to enter into this aviation industry. So do we have enough opportunities in Sri Lanka to train and bring in professionals in the aviation field?
Yeah, that is again a very valid and timely question. Now this ICAO has also predicted that the present level of operation of aviation would be double by 2030. And now more and more people will accordingly be required to keep the aviation industry going. So it is not an industry where you can just join and start working without proper training. So training is key to sustain the present achievement. And in this regard, we have identified this training need and started conducting various courses. But we have certain limitations because this aviation cannot only be learned by classroom training. You have to have on-the-job training. Now our on-the-job training facilities are limited because unless Sri Lankan Airlines gives some facility, engineers and pilots will not be able to get hands-on training. Similarly, air traffic controller can only be gaining experience by joining Airport and Aviation Services Limited. So they are, because our volume of work is limited, giving them OJT is also limited. So that is the main hurdle we are faced with. But we try to find solution by joining with other states where these people can be sent for OJT after being given the classroom training.
Now, my let me ask finally. We know that it's important for every citizen in this country to know about aviation, and people are eager to fly to the various destinations in the and so what sort of participation that you would expect the people of Sri Lanka in the aviation field, and how could your authority promote civil aviation in that respect?
If we look at our population, I think even 3% of our population may not have travel by air. So that is the other problem we have faced. But wherever possible, we try to give them the flying experience. Now, for instance, certain universities are conducting some aviation related topics, and whenever we ask, we try to send them on planes, at least from Mathala to internal traffic. But giving them the general opportunity of flying is difficult, because this air travel is considered to be a little expensive, and airlines are not willing to offer free travel. And also our people are not in a position to pay for the travel. There is some sort of a problem, but it has to be sorted out. Otherwise, this will not bring the benefit to the people. Yeah.
This morning in Coffee with Dan, I had Mr. H.M.C. Nimalsiri. He is the Director General of Civil Aviation and also the Chief Executive Officer of Civil Aviation Authority of Sri Lanka. We were discussing about civil aviation in Sri Lanka. Mr. Nimalsiri is an expert in the aviation industry, and he joined the aviation industry with aviation, civil aviation department, and rising up to the level of the Director General of Civil Aviation. I thank you, Mr. Nimalsiri, for being here in Coffee with Dan today.
Thank you very much, Dan.
We will join tomorrow with another interesting topic on Coffee with Dan.